Okay, hello and welcome to another Expert Inside interview. My name is John Golden from SalesPOP, online sales magazine, and Pipeliner CRM. Here from a beautiful San Diego. It's a fantastic day here today. Hate to break the news to everybody living in other parts of the world who may be, winter may be upon them. Sorry for the people on the East Coast, but it's a beautiful 80 degrees here today. I can't help, but it puts me in a good mood. And today I am joined by Arie Brish, who is in Austin, Texas. I'm assuming it's a beautiful day there too.
Surprisingly, yes. It's not predictable as Southern California, but today we have what we call a California weather.
Oh, good, good. Well, we like to share it with the world. And I'm originally from Dublin, Ireland, I have experienced the other side of it. So this is why I'm happy to celebrate days like today. Okay, so Arie is the author of the book Lay an Egg and Make Chicken Soup. I'm just going to show you the cover of it so everybody can take a look at it on Amazon and other good booksellers, as you can see it on screen. Lay an Egg and Make Chicken Soup, the holistic innovation process from concept to market expansion. So Arie, tell me first the genesis, or why you wrote this book, and what prompted you to write this in the first place?
Okay, that's an excellent question. In recent years, I mentored many entrepreneurs. Actually, over my career, I mentored people working for me, and I was mentored by wiser and people than me. And most recently, I mentored many young entrepreneurs where I was very impressed by their innovative ideas. But what I found out from my experience talking to probably hundreds of entrepreneurs in recent years is that they are lacking the experience, and therefore they don't know what to watch for, what risks they're facing, what landmines are in front of them, what blind spots they have. Most books in the innovation and venture genre focus mainly on the process of ideation, which is how to come with new ideas, and most of them focusing on how to raise money for your venture. Very few, if any, focus on the execution. After you got your brilliant idea, after you raised your $3 million, what's next? How can I make sure that 5 years later I make my investors richer and myself richer? So the entire book, or I would say 80% of the book, focus on the execution aspects. There is a little bit, two or three chapters talking about what makes a good idea and how to raise money. But the majority of the book is about how to execute on the innovation and make it a commercial success. By the way, I'm not just talking about startups.
Right.
Always talk, or in every chapter, I talk about a large company and a startup situation. Sometimes they have similar challenges. In many cases, there are different challenges. So every chapter talks about both.
Because it always seems to me, Arie, one of the problems is that people go from idea and then they go into execution, but they go into kind of really, they start to get down in the weeds very quickly and they miss that bit in the middle, right? The actual strategic planning piece, the looking at how we're going to execute. It's like people just go from idea and then just go straight into execution without a roadmap.
Exactly. So the book, the structure of the book, it has almost, you mentioned roadmap, it's every step in the way is a chapter in the book. So there is a chapter about accounting, a chapter about intellectual property. You guys focus on sales, a chapter about sales, a chapter about marketing. You name it, there is 20-something chapters, and each chapter, the structure of each chapter, it presents the challenge or what this I would say, business category contributes to the process of innovation. And then I bring two or three real life examples. Some are from my own experience. Some are examples that I picked up from public knowledge on the internet and books. And the third part of my sources are interviewing different entrepreneurs and different executives from different companies and get their perspective and their stories or lesson learned from their experience.
So one of the early chapters you talk about evaluating new product ideas, and I just thought it might be interesting just to talk about a little bit, because I do think that a lot of companies out there don't really have good processes for evaluating new ideas. A lot of it is done on gut, or yeah, just let's give it a whirl, or that sounds cool, yeah, let's try it, or that sounds that's never going to work. How should people really evaluate new product ideas?
Okay, that's the short answer is feedback from the market, of course. But the long answer, different in cases of B2B versus sure. B2C. So in B2B, you have very few customers that can give you feedback. You know, if you're an automotive, there are half a dozen large automotive companies that you need to talk to. Or if you're in a computer, there is half a dozen large computer companies you need to talk to. And the challenge there is, by the way, is find the right individuals in the company. Very often is more than one person. And you need to talk to few people. Each one brings a different perspective, right? I used to work for Motorola for 20 years, and we used to joke that if there is less than 50 people in the room, you cannot make a decision. So you need to make sure you talk to the right people in the company. In B2C is more about maybe have focus groups that test a new idea. And in those cases, you have to budget yourself. So let's say if you're a startup with a new consumer idea, maybe you don't have a budget to survey 20,000 people. So you start with a close circle of friends and family, maybe 20, 30 people you talk to. They'll do it for free for you, and you get their feedback, and then you take that to investors.
The bottom line is that you need to do some research. And I do think that a lot of times things are brought to market without a lot of in-depth research done on it. And here's another interesting thing that you mention in your book. One of your chapters is, in business, different is often better than better. Why do you say that?
Yeah, I love that title. Yeah. So there is always competition. Mm-hmm. So I get lots of clients coming to me, or potential clients coming to me, oh, we are 20% cheaper, or we are 20% faster, or we are 30% more beautiful, or whatever it is. That's not good enough, because your competition 2 or 3 years down the road, by the time you have your product out, your competition will be 30% more beautiful, or even better than that. Okay, so the trick is to differentiate your product in an angle that is completely untapped by your competition. Mm-hmm. One of my favorite examples, again, going back to my life at Motorola. Motorola used to be, I see some gray hair on your head, you may remember, they were the number one D leader in cellular phone. And back in the days, in the 1990s, not too long ago, the competition was initially based on quality of your voice or battery life. These were the main two parameters. Came Nokia in the middle of 1990s, and they realized that it's becoming such a commodity and such a popular accessory among teenagers that their whole differentiation was just coming up with different color selection. They didn't care much about the voice quality and what have you, but they gave you like 10 different colors to choose for, and they were a wild success. And even though it was easy to mimic them,
Sure.
Like just change the color, right? But all the other technology companies in the space look at them and says, you must be kidding. This is serious technology business, not about teenagers' colors. But guess who left all the way to the bank? Nokia did.
Sure. Sure. And I think that's a fantastic example, because it's a great example of actually tapping into what's important to a segment of your audience, right?
Yes,
instead of assuming or worse, telling your audience what's important to them, right? Because people don't really like to be dictated to, do they?
Yeah, right.
When you get into something like this, right, when you kind of figure out an angle, so different, even though difference, it has to be something that resonates with your audience, right? Not just difference for the sake of being different.
Yes, of course,
And then there's you also talk about, you just don't talk about this in abstract. You also talk about it from a human capital perspective, right?
Yes,
about how to the right organization and how you put that together and how you, in bringing something to market. So what are some of the elements when you're talking about building an organization around, you know, bringing your product or service to market?
Yes. Well, once again, it's the question is different.
Sure.
Large company and small company. In a large company, one of the challenges often is where to put this new product line in the entire organization. Very, very often, if it's such an innovative idea, there is no one division or one organization that naturally can take the responsibility to promote it. So one of the challenges often is to find an organization that will adopt the new idea. In many cases, if you find one, they will push back because of they're afraid that the new idea will compete with the old products. That's a huge risk in large companies.
Yeah.
That often happens. The cannibalism, internal cannibalism. So that management needs to watch for that. Another way to approach it is just create a new division that focus on this new idea. But once again, if you're the CEO of this large company, you need to be careful to make sure that the other lieutenants on your staff will not try to kill the baby.
Yeah, because just on that point, because we've seen this a lot of times, is where a company will have a product, right? And then they'll either bring out a brand new version of it, or and people go, I don't like this. I want the old one. The old one was just fine. Like, give me back the old one. I mean, we've seen that in a number of products where kind of like the install base like revolted against it. So again, that's just what you're talking about. You have to be very careful about when you make changes or when you bring out a new product to make sure that you're not out of sync with your audience.
Correct. So every it's a general statement. Every audience will have maybe you can divide to three. One is the early adopters, which will take any new idea just because it's new and they're curious about it. And then the second group is the early followers, the one that will, assuming the new idea, really the early adopters like it. Mm-hmm. The early followers will follow on. And then there is the late followers, those that, you know, follow two or three years later after everybody else tested it.
Yeah. And then you have people who, we experienced a year or so ago when Skype brought out its new version. And nobody liked it. We hated it, and we went and back and searched for the old install for the old one, and reinstalled the old one, and switched off automatic updates.
Yeah. Right.
So you have to be careful. And then subsequently, we moved off Skype to a different communication platform. But there you go. So what are some of the ways that you can mitigate against this kind of risk when you're bringing a new product or an enhanced or updated product to market?
Yeah. So that's, we talked about the large company risk. On a small company, the risk is a little different because you have a very small team. So the risk is too much dependency on one individual. And we've seen many startups failing just because the original technical technology founder got bored or got a better job offer and left the company, and the whole thing fell apart. So the if you're an investor in a small company like this, you need to really make sure that the team, the founding team, is committed and passionate about it and not going to leave next month for better paying jobs. This is one. The other one, very quickly build up a backup team. So if you have the junior CTO that came up with the original idea, make sure very quickly that two or three additional people in the team that can, you know, pick his brain or her brain and continue to run with the baton, even if the CTO leaves.
Yeah. And I think the basic underlying point here is don't just let things develop organically or just let them happen. You have to plan for each stage, right? For instance, like that, you have to start planning to have some kind of redundancy within the organization so that if somebody leaves, then everything doesn't go up in smoke.
Correct. And the internal CTO, normally, even if they're not leaving, they will keep some of their knowledge to themselves as a job security thing. Sure. So you, as the CEO of the company, have been in that chair several times. You have to incentivize them to share the knowledge, and otherwise it will be a lose-lose. The company will lose and the person will lose.
Yeah, exactly. Because it is very easy for people who, especially when they are in a startup and they start off something early, as the company gets maybe a little bit bigger, investors come in, it's very easy for the people just to go, I don't want to do this anymore. I'll just keep my shares and I'll go off do something else.
I'm as we speak this week, I was involved with two cases like this where the CTO basically left the company, and you have to struggle to find out how to compensate or how to make it up for the company so the company doesn't lose the knowledge.
So in other words, you need to be proactive rather than
absolutely
after the fact. All right, Arie, we're bumping up against the end of our time here, but just want to remind everybody again, the book is Lay an Egg and Make Chicken Soup, the holistic innovation process from concept to market expansion. And before we go, Arie, can you tell people a little bit more about yourself and how they can learn more about you? Obviously, your book is available on Amazon and all good booksellers, but how can they learn more about
you? Correct, so the book is available on Amazon and many other book chains. Almost every little bookstore in the U.S. carry that, at least online. So my background, I grew up in the high-tech industry, although I managed to turn and do totally different technology assignments with the same company. Motorola, for example, was nice enough and large enough to allow me to move every 3 to 5 years and do something different. Later on, I was involved with several startup initiatives, was co-founder of several startups, CEO of several startups. Most recently, I started to advise and provide strategic advisory and business development and fundraising help to multiple startups in different industries. And that's what opened my mind. And by the way, in the book, most of the examples, or all of the examples, are from a variety of industries, done so purposely, because you can learn from one industry to another. If you're a CEO of a hospital, you can learn from a CEO of an airline on some of the common issues or challenges.
Yeah. Well, this has been fascinating, Arie. So I want to thank you today for joining us. Again, the book is Lay an Egg and Make Chicken Soup. My name is John Golden from SalesPOP Online Sales Magazine and Pipeliner CRM. And I will see you all for another expert interview really soon. Thank you.
Thanks for having me. Bye-bye.